Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Alexander Hamilton and the Battle of Yorktown, October 1781, The Winning of American Independence, by Phillip Thomas Ticker, PhD, narrated by Justin Price. Introduction. In one of the great ironies in the annals of American history, Alexander Hamilton's special roles, especially as General George Washington's invaluable chief of staff for nearly 4 years, that he played during the American Revolution and in the making of America after the war, have left one of the important ones in relative obscurity. Although a recent emigrant to America, Hamilton made the most important and memorable contributions by far of the 32 members of Washington's staff. Most glaringly and surprisingly, the long list of Hamilton's accomplishments at the nerve center of Washington's headquarters and earlier in the war, including at the battles of Trenton and Princeton, New Jersey, during the 1776-77 campaign as a young commander of a New York artillery battery, have cast a giant shadow to this day over his all-important role during the crucial Yorktown campaign, in part because this was the last major campaign of the American Revolution. This relative obscurity in the historical record has been especially the case in regard to Hamilton's stirring role in leading the attack that captured Strategic Redoubt Number 10, which anchored the left flank of Lord Charles Cornwallis's lengthy defensive line on the York River on October 14, 1781, not long after the autumnal sun had dropped over the western horizon. But more than in the case of nearby Redoubt Number 9, which was overwhelmed by French troops at the same time, the capture of Redoubt No. 10 by Lieutenant Colonel Hamilton and his storming party of Continental Light Troops was key to turning Cornwallis's left flank of his sprawling siege line, which shortly forced his surrender. Only 5 days later, and thanks to the fall of Redoubt No. 10 and also Redoubt No. 9 to a lesser degree, Lord Cornwallis surrendered his British, Hessian, and Loyalist army in a broad field situated along the Hampton Road just outside Yorktown, the decisive turning point of not only the American Revolution, but also of world history, ensuring that the infant United States of America won its struggle for independence and gained a lengthy life as the newest People's Republic in the world. Clearly, Hamilton's special day of destiny came on Sunday, October 14, 1781, when a great deal was at stake in this war for America's liberty because Cornwallis was expecting the arrival of reinforcements from New York City as promised by his superior, Sir Henry Clinton. At that time, Hamilton audaciously tempted fate as never before. He lived to tell the tale of the harrowing experience in having led the headlong charge on formidable Redoubt No. 10 and having been the first American to scale the parapet and leap inside the earthen fortification, surviving numerous close calls at a time when his pregnant wife, Elizabeth Schuyler Hamilton in Albany, New York, was praying for his safe return home. Hamilton led the charge of his Continental Light troops over a broad stretch of open ground at a time when he had nothing to prove to anyone but himself because he had already demonstrated an abundance of courage as a gifted commander of a New York artillery unit. Nevertheless, he was so passionate about winning glory during this last chance that he risked all, an incredibly bright future, a beautiful, loving wife who hailed from one of America's leading families and carried his first child, Philip, an extremely supportive family of politically influential, wealthy in-laws who fully accepted him in every possible way despite his shadowy Caribbean background, and the high opinion that he enjoyed with General Washington and the Continental Army. His risk of all he had gained since migrating to America in 1773 reflected Hamilton's complex and paradoxical nature of enthusiastically embracing great challenges, even at the peril of his life. The unfortunate and almost unthinkable oversight by generations of historians and Hamilton scholars of Hamilton's role in the Revolution, and the Yorktown campaign especially, has partly stemmed from his service time. Hamilton served as a combat officer for only a few months during the war's final campaign, after having served on Washington's staff. Ironically, the importance of Yorktown, the brilliance of the combined offensive effort of the Allied generals Washington and Jean-Baptiste Donatien de Vimeur, Comte de Rochambeau, age 56, and the vital contributions of the French Navy that won superiority at sea, have overshadowed the key moment, estimated at only 20 minutes, that it took Hamilton and his crack light troops to capture Redoubt Number 10. Generations of historians have seemingly believed that Hamilton could have achieved relatively little of real importance on the war's last major battlefield in such a short time, during the most important siege in the annals of American history, fostering the misconception that his military service was relatively undistinguished at Yorktown, the antithesis of the actual situation. But in fact, from the beginning of the American Revolution to the end, young Hamilton excelled as a battlefield commander and leader of men, as both an artillery and infantry officer on the field of strife when not serving on Washington's staff. Indeed, the young native West Indian played key roles not only at Yorktown, but also as the commander of a New York artillery command before he joined Washington's staff on March 1, 1777, an impressive list of military contributions in leadership roles when not serving with distinction as a member of Washington's staff, remarkable for such a young officer and recent immigrant only in his 20s. In fact, very few, if any, Americans during this war possessed a more distinguished and impressive military record, both on and off the battlefield, or were at center stage of the most stirring events of the American Revolution, especially at Washington's headquarters, than Hamilton. Hamilton's rise both on and off the battlefield was meteoric, especially in regard to his vital role on Washington's staff from 1777 to 1781. With America's storied past, and even the lives of the Founding Fathers, in the process of being reanalyzed and reinterpreted in the United States as never before during the third decade of the 21st century, it is now time to re-examine the life of America's most controversial and gifted Founding Father, the only one not born in America. Alexander Hamilton was a product of the Caribbean, having been raised on the island of St. Croix in the Danish West Indies. In fact, he was far more of a West Indian than an American by the start of the American Revolution in April 1775. However, many American biographers, especially pro-American exceptionalism scholars, have portrayed Hamilton as a true blue American without acknowledging the significance of his deep immigrant roots, in no small part because his West Indies past was a dark one. Hamilton possessed the most tragic background of any founding father, with poverty, illegitimacy, and the Scottish father's abandonment. Most founding fathers hailed from largely stable and wealthy backgrounds. Despite his lowly beginnings, Hamilton was a man of destiny, whose intelligence and achievement shone brightly throughout the years of the American Revolution when he truly rose like the proverbial phoenix as Washington's invaluable right-hand man in the important role of chief of staff and all the way to his stirring role at Yorktown. From early 1777 to early 1781, no member of General Washington's personal staff was more important and indispensable than Hamilton, and no star shone brighter than that of Hamilton both on and off the battlefield year after year. However, the meteoric life of this remarkably gifted man from the West Indies was tragically cut short on July 11, 1804. By a small-caliber bullet fired from a dueling pistol of Aaron Burr, who was also a distinguished veteran of the Continental Army and a short-time member of Washington's staff, during the most famous duel in American history. Most notable as President George Washington's Secretary of the Treasury from 1789 to 1795, before tragedy struck because of Burr's steady aim on a New Jersey day at Weehawken on the Hudson River's western shore across from New York City, Hamilton had emerged as the chief ultranationalist and brilliant architect of a robust system of capitalism that laid the central foundation of modern America. Actually, Hamilton was the chief architect behind the nation's spectacular economic growth and dramatic rise to power that continued for generations and well into the 20th century. Quite simply, in both war and peace, Hamilton was the most gifted founding father despite his youth and relative inexperience. Hamilton's dramatic rise had been nothing short of spectacular, considering that he had first migrated to New York City on a sailing ship from the West Indies during the summer of 1773, less than 2 years before the start of the American Revolution. At that time, he had no place in America, a land of strangers and the largest region he had ever seen. Here, in a new land of limitless potential, he almost immediately fully embraced the great dream of America and what it promised to a young immigrant. For Hamilton, the outbreak of the American Revolution was a godsend, allowing greater opportunities for a young man of many unique talents without the usually required wealth, status, or family background, because of the dramatic rise of the spirit of republicanism and a new sense of equality. The gifted West Indian and former clerk of a large mercantile house from the small island of St. Croix was not only a prodigy, but also a genius who excelled with remarkable ease in multiple arenas. In this book, I have provided a detailed look at the dramatic course of the ever-eventful life of Alexander Hamilton, primarily in the Yorktown campaign. No previous book has been devoted to Hamilton's vital role during the most important campaign of the Revolutionary War. He seemed to have led multiple lives of importance in only a remarkably short time, and, unlike most, is actually more relevant today than ever before in many ways. His story is that of the American dream and limitless opportunities, which still applies to hardworking and industrious immigrants to the United States to this day. His story is a truly timeless lesson about the core meaning and overall importance of America. Indeed, the incredible story of Hamilton's life, which reads almost like a novel of historical romance created from an imaginative mind, has revealed a good many life lessons that still remain valid today for men and women around the world, especially to seize the day. A wise saying that first originated from a respected ancient Roman philosopher, carpe diem, or seize the day, has emphasized the wisdom for people, especially youth from disadvantageous backgrounds, to aggressively and boldly exploit opportunities to succeed. After he had escaped from his own Caribbean dead end, Hamilton seemed to have been blessed by fate and the gods, to which the ancient Romans had often paid their sacred devotion in return for their benevolence and favor in all areas of life. Throughout Hamilton's life, in which there never seemed to be a dull moment, he repeatedly demonstrated the timely wisdom of this ancient Roman philosophy to seize the day. This was a golden rule by which Hamilton lived, and one that repeatedly paid immense dividends to him in both war and peace. The fact that Hamilton repeatedly risked his life on battlefields from New York to Virginia, especially during the climactic showdown at Yorktown, to fulfill his ambitions and personal destiny, revealed the depth of the young man's character and commitment to his Republican vision of America. But although an intellectual, he was never an idle dreamer, but a man of action, which set him apart from all of the other founding fathers except Washington. For years, Hamilton struggled to make his grandiose vision of America become a reality by his own sacrifices and achievements, and he succeeded in the end. Because of today's political climate in the United States during the nation's most unheroic age, the America as originally envisioned by Hamilton has seemingly grown out of favor among many Americans with the rise of a mild brand of 21st century American socialism that has been naively thought to be preferable to Hamilton's envisioned style of capitalism, which had reaped so much national success and wealth. That's an entirely unimaginable political development in America only a few years ago, which has partly reflected the process of the overall dumbing down of America for generations in an inferior educational system that has become increasingly politicized and polarized. In idealistic terms, combined with naivete and an exuberant innocence, some active socialists in the United States today have embraced idealistic political concepts that are far too utopian and devoid of reality, especially in regard to history's timeless lessons, to be practical for the real world, which has been fully demonstrated throughout the course of history, especially during the 20th century and most famously in the Soviet Union. If alive today, diehard nationalist and capitalist Hamilton would have been absolutely appalled by the recent fast-paced developments in America. And in the ultimate irony, the political movement to change America by gradually moving toward the left occurred not long after the play Hamilton became the most successful and popular in the long history of Broadway plays, which especially appealed to people of a younger generation. However, it seems that while most people loved the music of Hamilton, they missed his long list of military achievements, especially at Yorktown, and his role as the primary creator of the American capitalist system. What has been often most minimized by generations of American historians, especially of the nationalist school of history, was the fact that he was a West Indian and a lowly immigrant to America. Hamilton's dramatic rise to prominence was nothing short of miraculous, a true Horatio Alger story. The fact that the West Indies consisted of largely a black population has caused the lack of focus on Hamilton's Caribbean background, long somewhat of an embarrassment to white nationalist historians, especially in regard to rumors that Hamilton possessed black blood from his mother's side because racial intermixing was so prevalent in the West Indies. But unlike any other founding father, Hamilton made his American dream come true by way of his own abilities and intelligence. The People's Revolution that overturned the old social order on the English model bestowed a host of new opportunities for Hamilton to make a name for himself in the military realm, first as a dynamic New York artillery commander of his own unit during the New York campaign and the Trenton-Princeton campaign, then as Washington's indispensable chief of staff for years, and finally as the leader of his own command, a full battalion of Continental Light Infantry troops who were the crack fighting men of the Continental Army. However, like a classic Greek tragedy in the end, this remarkable man of such incomparable talents and abilities needlessly threw his life away in the Aaron Burr duel that he did not have to fight. He was philosophically against the concept of dueling, especially since dueling had caused his teenage son Philip's death in November 1801. But of course, a cruel destiny had deemed otherwise by backing him into a corner to preserve his reputation and causing him to engage in what he never desired to do, ordaining an early end to his life in July 1804, a tragedy of immense proportions. Ironically, and as a strange fate would have it, Hamilton had survived dozens of close calls on the battlefield during the war years, only to be fatally cut down in a New Jersey dueling field at Weehawken by an equally talented man and the sitting vice president who had once been his comrade in arms during America's struggle for liberty. Like the throngs of immigrants who still eagerly come to America's shores today from around the world with visions of a better life for themselves and their families, so Hamilton had early viewed the immense potential and seemingly endless possibilities of this new land. As Hamilton learned when he first disembarked from a sailing ship on American soil in the summer of 1773 with little prospects or expectations, the 13 colonies were the antithesis of what he had known in the past. By the slimmest of margins, and thanks to sympathetic patrons, he had narrowly escaped the severely limited opportunities on St. Croix, where he had labored for years without prospects in the Kruger family trading firm of Kruger and Beekman. In the boundless expanse of America that was as big as its endless opportunities that existed during both peace and wartime for a smart, enterprising individual, Hamilton gained the chance to soar to unprecedented heights both during the war years and afterward. But the most opportunities came for the young West Indian because of the overturning of the old order by a revolution that was the first successful people's revolt against a powerful European monarchy. Quite simply, Hamilton was at exactly the right place at the right time to boldly seize the opportunities to rise higher in life, transforming himself from an outsider to an insider in record time when on American soil. When he had lived on the tiny island of St. Croix in the sweltering tropics and without future prospects at age 14, Hamilton wrote in a heartfelt letter, his earliest surviving letter, to his close friend Edward Ned Stevens in New York City on November 11, 1769. "I wish there was a war." Penned barely half a dozen years after the end of the Seven Years' War, known as the French and Indian War in America, his fondest wish eventually proved prophetic, because war was the key to his future recognition and fame, including the stirring role that he played during the dramatic showdown at Yorktown, Virginia, in less than a dozen years in the future. Strangely, Hamilton seemed to somehow know that his reputation would be made because of war, and that he was bound for greatness in the military realm far more than anyone, including himself, dared to imagine possible. Of course, Hamilton wrote his prophetic letter to Ned more than half a decade before the beginning of the American Revolution, when the Redcoats and a small band of Massachusetts militiamen clashed on Lexington Green on April 19, 1775, and he had no idea what lofty heights he would reach in faraway America. Indeed, in the end, Hamilton found not only his adopted home, destiny, and future in America, but also the conflict, nothing less than a world war after the French joined the American revolutionaries in 1778 with the signing of the Franco-American Alliance, that he had once so desperately desired to free him from a minuscule island in the West Indies. He boldly maneuvered behind the scenes, including with General Washington, to win the coveted assignment of leading one of the most dangerous and the most climactic assaults of the American Revolution at great risk to himself on the night of October 14, 1781, when so much was at stake. With the full strength of the French naval and land forces under the experienced and talented Comte de Rochambeau, France's best general who had been specially dispatched by King Louis XVI, now working closely together with Washington in Virginia, the general feeling in the army was that the revolution could be won at Yorktown. After years of faithful service to Washington on his staff, Hamilton jumped at the opportunity to secure the coveted role of leading the key attack in a position of honor on one of the most formidable British defensive positions at Yorktown. However, Hamilton's ambition to lead the attack on Strategic Redoubt Number 10 was much more than a selfish and greedy ambition. To young Hamilton and his revolutionary generation, nothing was more noble than the enlightened concept of republicanism, the political foundation of the infant American nation, and the basis of his enlightened, idealistic thinking during the war years, which fueled his risky actions on the battlefield. As a young man who had been educated in America since his relatively recent arrival from St. Croix in 1773, Hamilton had learned a good many historical lessons from the ancient classics, including the greatness of ancient Greek and Roman republicanism and democracy. In this sense, and like so many of the educated Continental officers, including fellow officers on Washington's staff like Tench Tillman of Maryland, Hamilton not only saw himself as a New World man, but also the very embodiment of a republican hero on the battlefield, like an ancient Greek or Roman warrior. These historical notions fueled Hamilton's motivations, while gaining for him the moral high ground by way of appropriate republican analogies in a common people's righteous struggle for liberty. At Yorktown, on the Virginia Peninsula beside the York River where Lord Cornwallis's army was trapped, Hamilton finally gained his long-awaited opportunity to emulate those ancient heroes of the distant past, his idols and models of true republican virtue. In a special fusion seen nowhere else to such an extent but in America among Washington's young Continental officers, the ancient Greek and Roman classics and the new sense of republicanism were interwoven to a degree almost unimaginable to the thinking of modern Americans. Symbolically, the once imposing Redoubt Number 10 on the Yorktown battlefield long ago eroded, washed away by time and the weather until nothing was left as a reminder. However, the people of the National Park Service have reconstructed the strategic, though now smaller and less imposing today than it appeared to Hamilton and his men at the time. And a visitor to the battlefield in today's York County, Virginia, will look in vain for an appropriate memorial or statue to Hamilton for his notable tactical achievement on the most decisive and important day of the Siege of Yorktown. Ironically, today, on the eve of the national celebration of the 250th anniversary of the American Revolution, an ever-increasing number of Americans who have become more cynical and politicized to a degree unimaginable only a few years before generally look unfavorably upon the Founding Fathers for primarily racial reasons, especially because two of the most prominent founders were large Virginia slave owners, George Washington and Thomas Jefferson. Even more, it has become increasingly popular, if not fashionable, today for young protesters of social injustice to commit criminal acts of defacing and even tearing down memorials to the Founding Fathers, especially those of Virginia slave owners, including Jefferson and Washington, because they had only fought for white liberty and not black liberty more than two centuries ago when the world was altogether different. However, What has been forgotten is that this ugly reality of a firm embrace of slavery stemmed from a calculated, original, Machiavellian decision of the Founding Fathers that was an absolute political necessity for the infant republic to guarantee a successful uniting of North and South so that all the states would come together as one to fight against the world's strongest imperial power from the Atlantic's other side, the New Rome. Unfortunately, this absolute political necessity for national survival of a weak republic compromised the Revolution's most enlightened principle, as emphasized by Jefferson, that all men are created equal. This unfortunate development was the high price of going to war against a powerful old world monarchy that ruled a vast empire and sought to impose its imperial will and autocratic authority on the American people. Generations of the unfortunate people of African descent paid the ultimate personal price for the fulfillment of America's liberty, sacrificed on its altar in the very beginning. Quite simply, there would have been no successful revolution if slavery, a basic foundation of the national economy, had been abolished early according to the egalitarian principles of the Age of Enlightenment. In today's increasingly popular and widespread condemnation of the Founding Fathers for having betrayed fundamental egalitarian principles of the American Revolution because they failed to promote the cause of black liberty, even Hamilton has been most recently targeted by politically correct advocates of what has become a fashionable popular movement supported by the mass media and Hollywood because it is today's most trendy form of demonstrating moral outrage and indignation, especially on the internet, based on a sense of self-reconfirming righteousness. In 2019 and 2020, even the popular Broadway play Hamilton came under fire because of its lack of sensitivity toward the ugly truths of race and slavery in colonial and revolutionary America. Ironically, Hamilton became the most popular in Broadway history, in part because it had skirted such political and emotionally charged issues like slavery. As part of this sharp backlash, The Washington Times released a hard-hitting story on February 7, 2019, entitled Lin-Manuel Miranda's Hamilton Under Fire for Ignoring Founding Fathers' Complicity in Slavery. However, this glaring omission of a much-needed focus on the institution of slavery in the Broadway play Hamilton has been most ironic. When it came to slavery, Hamilton was actually the least deserving of all the Founding Fathers to have today come under any kind of criticism. Indeed, what has been most overlooked about Hamilton when he was serving on Washington's staff was the key role that he played in promoting the recruitment of black slaves to fight for their own liberty when America faced a manpower crisis during a war of attrition. War weariness and apathy among whites had grown extremely high across America after so many defeats and ever-increasing battlefield losses. Two distinct liberation efforts of the common people, one black, one white, of America were closely intertwined, as Hamilton early realized, because the love of liberty knew no color, and this struggle was one that naturally erased color lines and prejudice in the name of freedom for all. Along with his friend, Lieutenant Colonel John Lawrence, who had also served on Washington's staff, Hamilton was one of the leading advocates for the use of black soldiers, or slaves, who would fight for their own freedom and that of America. Then, after the war, Hamilton fought politically against the Jeffersonian vision of an agrarian society of yeoman farmers who were also slave owners, especially in the South, but also in the North, where slavery had not been abolished in some cases. He promoted the concept of a prosperous nation based on a strong industrial base instead of a robust institution of slavery. To criticize the play Hamilton today because of its shortcomings in regard to the subject of slavery is the greatest irony of all, because Hamilton was the biggest abolitionist of the Founding Fathers, which reveals the lack of historical insight of the critics today. Indeed, Hamilton was an abolitionist at an early date to a degree unimaginable to Washington and Jefferson, who were two of Virginia's largest slave owners to the end of their lives. After the war, Hamilton was one of the founders of the New York Manumission Society and was more open-minded about race than most founding fathers, especially those men from the South. He advocated for the use of black soldiers because of the equality of black abilities and intellectual capabilities to whites long before the first gun was fired in anger at Yorktown. In Hamilton's words from a mid-March 1779 letter, "I have not the least doubt that the Negroes will make very excellent soldiers." Ironically, Hamilton won his greatest battlefield glory in America's largest slave state and on behalf of one of the world's largest slave-owning nations at a time when he was an abolitionist at heart by way of his own words and actions, to a degree rarely seen from any American at the time. Hamilton and his best friend John Lawrence, another gifted member of Washington's staff, not only led the charge together at Yorktown, but also earlier advocated a bold plan, which was formally presented to the Continental Congress, for black freedom and equality during the war years, one of the boldest emancipation plans before the Civil War. Clearly, Hamilton was more forward-looking, enlightened, and egalitarian about race than any other founding father, and his actions and words over the years revealed as much. Ron Chernow's highly acclaimed 2004 masterpiece, Hamilton, upon which the popular Broadway play Hamilton was based and which was the finest Hamilton biography yet written, devoted less than 5 pages to the important story of Hamilton's role at Yorktown. In consequence, this book will thoroughly explore the subject. To his great credit, Chernow is today's leading biographer and historian of Hamilton because his book is nothing short of brilliant on multiple levels. But the all-important Yorktown story was surprisingly minimized and neglected in this fine work of more than 800 pages. However, this highly acclaimed Hamilton biography has provided an example of how the significance of Hamilton's role at Yorktown has been given a relatively light touch, even by one of America's most gifted biographers and writers. This omission has motivated the writing of this book to fill the missing gaps in the historical record as much as possible. More than half a decade ago, when I had the privilege of writing the 2017 book, Alexander Hamilton's Revolution, His Vital Role as Washington's Chief of Staff for Skyhorse Publishing, which became a selection of the History Book Club, the dramatic story of Hamilton at Yorktown was minimized by this current author, but only because it was outside his Chief of Staff role. However, this current book tells the full story of Hamilton at Yorktown to a degree unlike any previous book, because it is so important to be fully understood and appreciated on the eve of the 250th anniversary of the American Revolution. This current book was also written because Hamilton's story is still important and relevant to this day for a variety of reasons. What the young West Indian demonstrated at Yorktown was not only heroic in the traditional sense, but also a reminder of the high cost of liberty and how difficult it was to obtain and keep it. A valuable lesson that still applies not only in America, but also around the world today. All in all, it was most fortunate for the United States that Hamilton survived leading the daring charge on formidable Redoubt Number 10, because he was more responsible for the making of modern America as we know it today than any other founding father, as President Washington's brilliant Secretary of the Treasury. The overall purpose of this book has been to bring Alexander Hamilton to life as much as possible, especially by relying on his own words to reveal the real person. In many ways, and especially because of his prolific writings that were penned with an unparalleled eloquence, intelligence, and honesty, he can be seen today as the most human and accessible of all the founding fathers. In his revealing letters, Hamilton displayed a mixture of wit and wisdom not seen in the words of any other founding father except Benjamin Franklin, which has made him come alive more than any other founding father. Too often the founding fathers have been portrayed as marble men, poised on the Mount Olympus of American icons, impossible for the average person today to get to understand. Fortunately, such is not the case with the multi-talented Hamilton, a true Renaissance man. The extent of Hamilton's writings was so wide-ranging that it is now possible for listeners to almost feel like they know Hamilton not only as a person, but also intimately. Therefore, this current book will quote Hamilton's own words as much as possible, including before and especially during the Yorktown campaign. and Hamilton accomplished so much during the war and afterward, despite, or because of, possessing inner demons from a murky and shadowy Caribbean past. Some false rumors even maintained that he had black blood because of his illegitimate birth in a land dominated by slavery and where the black population far outnumbered the white population, and a distinct penchant for high drama seemingly wherever he went, and far more than any other founding father. Despite his prolific writings, however, Hamilton was still very much Sphinx-like because he was a man without a past who was unknown in America, and this dark obscurity of his Caribbean days primarily fueled his spectacular rise to prominence. Despite having been a man of rare genius at a relatively young age, he was still very much a common man, one example of his contradictory personality. Because of what he accomplished at Yorktown on October 14th, and thanks to major colonial newspapers, especially those located in the capital of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, Hamilton's name finally became well known across America for the first time. The 21st century has become America's most unheroic age, partly because of the widespread and growing influence of political correctness and the dominance of the self-serving personal and political agendas of the Internet age, the older values of a more heroic age which had long defined the course of human history in many cultures around the world, have been largely erased, thanks partly to the comfortable convenience of looking at history in hindsight through a tainted, politicized lens entirely out of focus because of today's fashionable political agendas and popular partisan politics. Not only the United States flag, but also decorated military veterans who have fought to preserve America's freedoms and risked their lives in foreign lands have been routinely mocked because partisan politics and political agendas have become so popular today. Even the Congressional Medal of Honor and their proud winners have been recently dishonored by people who know little, if anything, about the military or history because of political falsehoods, a failed American educational school system that has been politicized, and the influence of morally corrupt political leaders motivated by self-serving agendas. Compared to today, and as noted, the period of the American Revolution was America's most idealistic heroic age on multiple levels, as embraced by the Revolutionary War generation, especially Age of Enlightenment leaders and the Founding Fathers, including Hamilton. And none of these revolutionary leaders were more thoroughly imbued with the concept of the meaning of republicanism found in the ancient classics than the Founding Fathers, who modeled their infant republic upon the political and social lessons learned from the ancient classics. Founders like Jefferson and Washington's young staff officers, including Hamilton, knew all about the stories of famous republican leaders and institutions of ancient Greece and Rome and Homer's ancient Greek heroes of the Iliad and the Odyssey. Indeed, Alexander Hamilton, like his equally idealistic young friends John Lawrence and Tench Tillman, who also served on Washington's staff and were educated at leading colleges, had studied and learned about the ancient classics at King's College, today's Columbia University, and other institutions of higher learning in the Northeast. It is certainly now time to not only look anew at Alexander Hamilton and the Yorktown campaign in greater detail, but also to explore the generally minimalized French role, especially in regard to the supreme importance of naval superiority, which was the key to decisive victory. For a wide variety of reasons, including that he was the most dynamic and controversial founding father, both on and off the battlefield, the remarkable story of young Lieutenant Colonel Hamilton and his key role at Yorktown will be explored and analyzed more thoroughly than in any previous book to enlighten listeners about one of the vital architects to decisive victory at Yorktown during the most important chapter of American history. Most of all, Hamilton's. What should not be forgotten was the belief in divine intervention. Hamilton had seemingly been sent to America in 1773 at exactly the right time by a benevolent and kind providence, especially at Yorktown. Above all other factors, Washington sincerely believed that a kindly providence was most of all responsible for the creation of the United States of America and the winning of the American Revolution for the benefit of all mankind. In fact, the entire People's Revolution was based on the unique popular concept that America needed no king in Europe because it already had a king and higher authority to guide it, God. Because Hamilton played so many vital roles, it almost seemed to many people, perhaps even Washington, as if he had been heaven sent to America from the West Indies. Clearly, at this late date, Alexander Hamilton must be viewed from an entirely new and fresh perspective, especially because he was the foremost abolitionist of all the founding fathers. He utterly rejected the Jeffersonian vision of a thriving American agricultural economy based on a vibrant institution of slavery, which darkly tainted the idealistic egalitarian vision, the promise of the infant republic, and the overall American experiment conceived in liberty. In much the same way, so a new view of Lieutenant Colonel Hamilton's distinguished role at Yorktown needs to be looked at, because he successfully orchestrated and conducted nothing less than the most climactic and vital assault on a strategic position during the course of the American Revolution on the night of October 14, 1781, that forced Lord Cornwallis to surrender his entire army and changed the course of history. Phillip Thomas Ticker, PhD. Chapter 1. Frustrated young man of Scottish-French descent from the West Indies. Ever the contrarian and maverick, after having been born on the tropical island of Nevis and raised as an orphan on the island of St. Croix in the Danish West Indies, young Alexander Hamilton had become heartily sick and tired of the most popular and esteemed military man in America by early 1781. This revered individual had become world-famous because he symbolized America's Revolutionary War effort and commanded the Continental Army, while Hamilton was saddled with the demons of a dark past, including an illegitimate birth in the Caribbean. Idolized around the world, General George Washington, a former Virginia militia officer before the war and veteran of the French and Indian War, was lionized by not only the American people, but also much of the freedom-loving world, especially France. However, young Lieutenant Colonel Hamilton had seen considerable shortcoming in the Commander-in-Chief, including how he treated subordinates shabbily, like he was still the master of Mount Vernon and a large number of slaves. Hamilton had seen the sudden and unpredictable outbursts of his fierce temper, especially in times of high stress, which Washington sought to control his entire life, but often failed miserably. As Washington's top staff officer and indispensable chief of staff, who had performed brilliantly from early 1777 to early 1781 while only in his mid-20s, at a time when he looked younger because of his boyish handsomeness, unbridled enthusiasm, and endless energy in having danced for hours at fashionable balls with some of the day's most beautiful women, Hamilton faced a serious dilemma for which he had no solution. He had labored long and hard in the shadow of America's greatest hero, and now seemed trapped. As long demonstrated at headquarters, no one could speak more intelligently about so many diverse and complex subjects, especially those that were economically and politically related, than the gifted Hamilton. And Washington fully realized as much, knowing that Hamilton, who was overflowing with ideas and solutions to problems, was crucial as the head of his staff in almost too many ways to count. The Commander-in-Chief of the Continental Army wisely knew that he needed Hamilton by his side throughout much of the war, a realization that ran in direct conflict with the talented native West Indian's ambitions, including a well-deserved promotion denied by Washington because it might free him from Washington's group of hard-working young staff officers. However, by early 1781, Hamilton thought much differently from almost all other patriots about America's most revered leader, whom everyone called His Excellency. Daily contact with Washington had changed his opinion. Despite having become the most famous man in America, Washington was quite provincial in many fundamental ways and still very much of a common Virginia plantation owner, but a rich one. This situation especially applied to Washington's inferior education, both military and civilian, which was duly noted by Hamilton because it was so glaringly obvious. After all, Washington was a former Virginia militia colonel and large tidewater planter who had only once departed America's shores when he had journeyed to the West Indies, whereas Hamilton, familiar with different cultures and languages of Western Europe, was far more sophisticated, erudite, and cultured. The young man knew the tricky and complex ways of the international world from his years of working with the Kruger International Trading Firm on St. Croix, which was located at the center of a booming international trade. Despite his youth, therefore, Hamilton was far more worldly than the tall planter and aristocratic gentleman farmer from Mount Vernon, which stood on the bluffs of Fairfax County overlooking the Potomac River and southern Maryland on the river's west side. Even more, Hamilton was nothing short of a genius, whose intellectual abilities towered above those of Washington, which allowed him to make key contributions and bestow sage advice to the commander-in-chief about political, economic, and military matters. He assisted Washington immeasurably at headquarters in a variety of ways, helping him to make the proper decisions and sage judgments in leading America's war effort. Despite his many achievements as Washington's invaluable chief of staff, Hamilton was virtually unknown outside of the staff and top leaders of the Continental Army because he had been a recent immigrant, 1773, to America from the Caribbean and a former commander of a New York artillery unit, the Provincial Company of Artillery. He had led his New York gunners with tactical skill and aggressiveness since March 1776, and played key roles during the dreary retreat south from the evacuated New York City, and then during the battles of Trenton and Princeton, New Jersey. These were Washington's first battlefield victories in late December 1776 and early January 1777, respectively. Even more, Hamilton was an open-minded internationalist and brilliant economist and political thinker, far beyond the knowledge of an average top staff officer, overflowing with innovative ideas and novel concepts that were generally alien to military men. He had long expressed his own well-defined thoughts in masterful writings in the form of official army orders and documents to which Washington readily gave his approval. For instance, during Washington's first meeting with the leader of France's expeditionary force, General Jean-Baptiste Donatien de Vimur, Comte de Rochambeau, at the Hartford Convention in Connecticut in September 1780, the commander-in-chief brought an 8-page draft, written by Hamilton in French, for Rochambeau that proposed a joint attack on New York City. Another simmering source of inherent friction and unease, albeit unconscious, existed between Washington and Hamilton, which had been overlooked by generations of American historians. Young Lieutenant Colonel Hamilton believed in freeing slaves if they fought for America in all black battalions with white officers, and had boldly put those thoughts in writing in 1779, while Washington was one of America's largest slave owners and a member of Virginia's upper-class planter elite. And after nearly 4 years, Hamilton had also certainly tired of always addressing Washington as His Excellency, like he was King George III himself on his throne, while watching the commander-in-chief being treated by all like some kind of a deity. Because of his past subservient clerking position for the wealthy Kruger family on St. Croix, Hamilton especially detested the excessively deferential role that he had long played in Washington's shadow while serving on his staff, and only did so for so long for the overall good of America, while making Washington a much better and more insightful general in the end. Therefore, Hamilton gradually grew to resent Washington, especially during some of the most stressful periods of the war when the Patriots were losing. This was especially the case in the South after the British, under Sir Henry Clinton, captured Charlestown, later Charleston, South Carolina, in May 1780. This port city on the Atlantic was the largest and most strategic of the South, and its surrender was the largest Patriot disaster of the war. Especially vexing to the young man, Lieutenant Colonel Hamilton had failed to gain eagerly sought-after positions of importance, including the adjutant general position under the highly capable General Nathaniel Greene, who was Washington's top lieutenant, and as a prestigious special minister to France by appointment of the Continental Congress. Because of his fluency in French, his keen intelligence, and his well-honed diplomatic qualities, Hamilton would have been an ideal choice for the crucial effort to gain additional French assistance for the sagging war effort. However, Hamilton was an unknown to the politicians of the Continental Congress, and he failed to gain the coveted diplomatic position, to his great disappointment, and unfortunately for the overall war effort. And Washington gained all the fame and glory for being America's savior and Republican idol, While Hamilton had long continued to work hard behind the scenes and make important contributions without recognition for nearly 4 years. Hamilton could never forget how, as commander of a New York artillery unit prior to becoming Washington's chief of staff, his trained gunners from New York had protected Washington's retreat south near New Brunswick in central New Jersey to keep the pursuing Redcoats and Hessians at a distance while the reeling Continental Army moved steadily south toward Trenton, New Jersey. The long and miserable retreat south to safe Pennsylvania set the stage for Washington's surprise attack on the Hessian brigade of 3 regiments at Trenton on the snowy morning of December 26, 1776. At this time, Washington's army was extremely vulnerable because of a series of recent losses and humiliating defeats around New York City, including the city's loss, which had eroded morale and caused widespread desertions in the ever-dwindling ranks of the reeling Patriot Army. Hamilton's distinguished role on the west side of the Raritan River, the largest river located entirely in New Jersey, in protecting the Army's withdrawal toward Trenton, first brought him to Washington's attention. Most important, he helped to ensure that Washington's army would survive to fight another day by keeping Cornwallis at arm's length, ironically the same commander who Hamilton was destined to face at Yorktown. Captain Hamilton's vital last stand at the Raritan River was additional evidence that this talented young officer was actually more of a battlefield commander than just another desk officer in the traditional sense, not only because of his aggressive nature, but also his tactical skill and natural instincts. Worst yet, in Hamilton's way of thinking, Washington had personally thwarted the young man's repeated bids to depart headquarters and take a field command to get back to doing what he loved, leading men once again into action from the front and by inspiring example when he was more qualified for those coveted field positions now filled by other Continental officers of less ability. Lieutenant Colonel Hamilton realized that the idea to deny promotion was shared by high-ranking officers and his friends, especially members of Washington's staff who were in the know. Of course, there was nothing malicious about Washington's repeatedly thwarting Hamilton's ambitions. After all, Hamilton was simply too invaluable to Washington on multiple levels to be allowed to leave his headquarters to seek glory on the battlefield when so much work remained to be completed and a war had to be won. No Continental officer had accomplished more significant milestones in dual roles, both on and off the battlefield, in the desperate bid to win a new nation's independence since 1775, than Hamilton. This was a striking paradox, because he seemed to have been the most unlikely of American heroes because of his lowly social standing, illegitimate birth, impoverished beginnings, and miserable boyhood in the West Indies. All in all, the haunting memories of this dark legacy from the West Indies propelled him to overachieve in seemingly every single endeavor that he enthusiastically embarked upon in America, especially in the military realm, but also in the field of economics.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.